The views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
Hi, and welcome to Open BxRx Tuesday on BronxNet, a weekly program providing you the latest information, resources, services, and community efforts taking place locally here in the Bronx and virtually. I'm your host, Kim and Alleyne. Coming up, the Biden administration passes a bill categorizing lynching as a federal hate crime. A public historian and author joined me to discuss the Emmett Till Anti-Lynching Act. Why are we now seeing a federal response to this? Then President Biden put a pause on student loan debt until May 2022. Now that deadline is just a month away. Senior strategic organizer for RootsAction joined me to discuss student debt cancellation. Does Biden actually have the power to do this on his own? After that, a program dedicated to learning about the art of cooking is looking for new applicants. The Director for Continuing Education and Workforce Development at Hostos Community College joins me to discuss the first course apprenticeship program. How can this apprenticeship help out the next generation of chefs? And finally, one woman is using her platform to inspire and positively influence school and business professionals. Could understanding your identity strengthen your success professionally? So please stick around, Open BxRx Tuesday starts now. Welcome to Open BxRx Tuesday on BronxNet. I'm your host, Kibin, and I'd like to invite you to get social with us at BronxNet TV on Instagram and Twitter and BronxNet Community Television on Facebook. The Biden administration announced there is now a federal law that designates lynching as a federal hate crime. The Emmett Till Anti-Lynching Act comes decades and nearly a century after failed attempts to outlaw lynching. Public historian and author Michelle Duster joins me to discuss the passage of this long overdue bill. Michelle, thank you so much for joining me.
Well, thanks for having me, Kibin.
So President Joe Biden signed a bill into law that makes lynching a federal hate crime. What were your initial thoughts on this when you heard the news that this could be happening?
I felt a sense of relief. This has been a long time coming, over 124 years since my great-grandmother Ida B. Wells visited the White House to talk with President William S. McKinley about enacting this legislation. So finally, several generations, it's become a reality.
Now, I feel like this is a very well-known story, but for those who don't know, can you tell us about the history of Emmett Till and why this is actually so significant?
Well, when Emmett Till was a 14-year-old boy who visited Mississippi from Chicago in 1955, and he was accused of whistling to a white woman, and her husband and a couple of other people kidnapped him and tortured him, killed him, and threw him into the river. And so this was an egregious act of violence against a child. And his mother, Aunt Minnie Till Mobley, held an open casket funeral so the whole world would be able to see how people treat African Americans. And it was what made an impact because he was so young and accused of such I don't know when whistling is a crime. So it just really made an impact.
Now, as you mentioned, this occurred in 1955. And I feel like the older I get, the more it doesn't feel like it's that long ago. But it was quite some time ago. Why do you think we're now seeing a federal response to this?
Well, we're seeing a federal response to making lynching a hate crime. The bill was named after Emmett Till, but lynching has been a part of our country's history ever since the Civil War. So we've had over 160 years of this violence, this mob rule that was prevalent from the end of the Civil War until maybe the 1930s or 40s. But there still have been lynchings since then, because the definition of lynching is murder at the hands of a mob. And so extrajudicial killing. And one could argue that Ahmaud Arbery's murder was a lynching.
Now, you were actually there to see the Emmett Till Anti-Lynching Act get put into place. And as you mentioned, over 100 years ago, your great-grandmother and historical figure, Ida B. Wells, visited the White House in an attempt to enact an anti-lynching legislation. What was it like to see this in person and actually be there to kind of witness history?
It was an honor to actually have the opportunity to literally witness history real time. It made it real. And I felt a sense of relief, as I'm sure many people did, to make this into law. And what it does is it makes lynching into categorized as a hate crime, which makes it, for it to be federal law, that means that federal investigations would be done of this type of crime versus leaving it to local and state officials.
Now, I must admit, I think it's a little disappointing to learn that Congress had tried and failed more than 200 times to outlaw lynching. What message do you think this sends to our country?
Well, it takes a while to have legislation passed and to have crimes that have been committed against, that pretty much have been racially based crimes that traditionally and historically were committed against mostly African Americans, and many times they were committed by people who were part of the law. So they were the sheriff, they were the judge, they were the attorneys, and so it's hard to get justice when the people who are supposed to be protecting you are committing the crimes. So by this becoming law, it will take the investigation out of the local situation and to a federal investigation.
I'm really grateful that you actually mentioned that, because I don't think a lot of people understand that. Like you mentioned, that the people who were doing this were a part of the law. So I thought that was like really brilliant that you added that. Now, according to NPR, the maximum sentence for a perpetrator convicted under the Anti-Lynching Act is 30 years when conspiracy to commit a hate crime results in death or serious bodily injury. Do you think this is fair considering the crime?
Well, I think what's significant about that particular part of the law is the fact that a person can be convicted for lynching, hate crime, if they conspire to commit a lynching. And that makes it even more extensive. And so for that, I mean, I think that is fair. If you conspire to lynch somebody, that you can be tried and convicted for 30 years.
Now, although lynching is commonly associated with slavery and the Jim Crow era, our country has seen the lynching of African Americans as recent as 2019. In a time where it feels like white supremacy and white nationalists have a resurgence, do you have faith that this will make an impactful change in our country?
Well, the difference between before this lynching act was passed and now is basically the law. You can't legislate morality. But you can legislate the law. And so this would be in effect, if somebody does commit the crime, then how they would be punished and how the crime would be investigated is what's the difference with this law.
Now, over the past few years, we finally addressed some of the terrors many African Americans face on a national scale. And I believe that we've thought critically about the African American experience, probably more so than we have publicly in years prior. What do you think contributed to that?
Well, I think it's just, you know, Black people have been in this country for 400 years, and it's really time for us to have the same level of protection as anybody else in this country. And so this legislation does provide that level of protection against a crime that has been primarily inflicted on the African-American community. It was a form of domestic terrorism, and it's important to have laws against this type of mob rule that was prevalent during my great-grandmother Ida B. Wells' time.
Now, I want to add that what do you think social media has played a part in the education of learning about Black history, do you think it's made a huge difference, or do you think there's something else that has kind of educated or got more people to be interested in learning about Black American history?
Well, I think there's two things going on in our country right now. I mean, one is, you know, this push to make sure that people are educated about our history and are able to celebrate those even who are lesser known heroes in our history. But then there's also an effort to make sure that this history is not taught. And so I think sometimes the more resistance there is to teaching and learning about it, the more resistance there is to teaching about it. So you have these sort of counter efforts going on at the same time.
Now, you've been working for over 30 years, so I'd like to take a moment to highlight some of the work you've done in regards to racial and gender equity. Your services have led to major changes. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Well, I'm based in Chicago, and I was involved in having a national monument created in honor of my great-grandmother, Ida B. Wells. I was involved in having a major street renamed after her, historical marker, an honorary street, and then most recently a suffrage mural, which includes 10 women, including my great-grandmother. And then nationally, I have been involved in a couple of other monuments that are to suffragists, as well as I just came from a street renaming ceremony in Memphis. So the city of Memphis is starting to recognize my great-grandmother in public history projects as well. There are also markers that are being placed around the country in honor of victims of lynching. It's important for us to remember their names and to remember their humanity. So there are multiple projects, as well as I've written several books, including Ida B. the Queen and Ida B. Wells' Voice of Truth.
Now, can you actually tell us a little bit more about your great-grandmother? I think a lot of people know about her, but for those who don't know, can you tell us more about just the impact she's had on Black American history?
Right. Well, my great-grandmother, Ida B. Wells, was born enslaved in 1862, Holly Springs, Mississippi. And she went on to become a pioneering data journalist, investigative journalist, a civil rights activist, a suffragist. She was one of the co-founders of the NAACP and the National Association of Colored Women's Clubs. And so she was involved in many situations or many initiatives to basically fight for first-class citizenship for African Americans and women.
All right, thank you so much. And before I let you go, I just want to get your opinions on this. I know that recently there have been a lot of movies about Black American history. And I just want to get your thoughts as somebody who works so well within that field. Do you think that these movies are necessary, or do you think there should be another way to educate the public on Black American history?
I think every way that is possible to educate people is important. There's nothing wrong with having multiple mediums that tell the same information. In fact, Mattel just created an Ida B. Wells doll for their Inspiring Women series. And so that's yet another way that people can learn about history, learn about my great-grandmother and several other people who are included in that series. So all of it matters, you know. Dolls, books, movies, public history projects as far as monuments and markers and murals, cartoons, I mean, whatever we can do to get this information out for every age level.
All right, Michelle, thank you so much. Before you go, can you just let everybody know how they can keep in touch with you?
The easiest way is I'm at Michelle Duster on Facebook and Instagram, and on Facebook at MLD Wrights, WRITES.
All right. Thank you so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me, Kevin.
We'll be right back with more Open BxRx Tuesday.
Thank you.
Welcome back. Several months ago, the Biden administration put a pause on student loan debt until May 2022. Now that deadline is just a month away, and activists are calling on for the cancellation of student debt once again. Senior strategic organizer for organization RootsAction, India Walton, joins me to discuss the fight against student debt. India, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you so much for having me.
So before we jump into this conversation, I'd like to know a little bit more about your organization. Can you tell me about RootsAction?
Sure. RootsAction is an organization that is dedicated to digital organizing. That is really a way for folks who our Twitter warriors, our Facebook warriors, our email warriors to stay in tune and get activated in turn sort of our digital organizing into meaningful in-person and action through in-person direct actions and also through donations, letter writing campaigns, email campaigns to really push and pull the levers of power in this the great United States of America.
So this has been an ongoing fight for many people, but you've launched a campaign in regards to student debt. Can you tell me more about that and what actually inspired it?
Yeah, so RootsAction really is sort of coming in as an amplifier for the campaign. We have great organizations like the Debt Collective that have been working on canceling student debt for a number of years, and enter India Walton that now has this newfound platform to be able to bring in more people. So RootsAction decided to go and just be an amplifier and act as an accompaniment to the Cancel Student Debt campaign to be able to bring more voices and more ears to the campaign so that we can actually get this done.
So the issue of student debt continues to be a major concern for many people across our country. During his administration, Biden had promised a lot. Can you give us an overview of this in regards to student debt?
Well, you know, we saw this election really dependent upon Black and brown people, young people, working class people to get Biden into office. And one of the things that was promised during his campaign was the cancellation of student debt. And during various periods of time, he promised us $10,000. There have been folks who called for $50,000. But right now, we sense a need of urgency to cancel all student debt. We know that it will be an economic driver. We know that it will be something that can really tackle the social, economic, and racial disparities in the racial, economic wealth gap. And this is something that can happen today that the president can do to really deliver on the promises that we were sold during his campaign.
So I love that you brought up the racial, just bringing up anything regarding race and background like that. And I definitely want to dig into it a little bit deeper later on. But last time we spoke with your organization, the student debt pause was extended 3 months from its original date of January 31st. Where do we stand with all of this right now?
Well, student loan payments are set to resume on May 1st, May Day, which is actually International Workers' Day, which is something that is just blows my mind that we're even considering doing it on a day that is supposed to honor international workers and working class people. But what we've seen is that over the course of the last 2 years, the pause on student debt has allowed folks to do things with that income that they wouldn't otherwise be able to do. And knowing that payments are set to resume, there are a lot of people who are in a state of panic, myself being one. You know, I'm able to put my son in extracurricular activities and do things that I wouldn't be able to do if I had to pay $600 a month in student loan repayment. So I just think that not only pausing student debt and extending the pause, but also just canceling it altogether will be a great economic driver and is going to do a lot for the economy and to help close the gap that Black and brown people, especially women, Black women like me, have been facing for so long.
Now, I know on the website you have like a visual countdown, and I really like that because I feel like it gives a sense of urgency. Can you tell me a little bit more about that countdown?
I feel that countdown in my bones. You know, knowing that there are just days until payments resume, right? Like, we plan our lives around the bills we have to pay. You know what's due on the first of the month. You know what's due on the third of the month. You know what's due on the 15th of the month. And it's, for a lot of us, either we have to cut something. Unlike people who have multi-billion-dollar budgets, like our state and local governments, or multi-trillion-dollar budgets, like our federal government, we have to make decisions based on the day-to-day, the week-to-week, and the month-to-month. And knowing that student loan payments are going to resume on May 1st means that I have some tough decisions to make. And people like me also have tough decisions to make. Are we going to pay for childcare? Are we going to pay for health care? Are we going to pay for the healthy food that we've been eating? Or are we going to continue to enrich the rich? Are we going to continue to, you know, pay these predatory loan repayment and bill collectors on behalf of the federal government? Or are we going to be relieved of that heartache, that pain, the crushing debt that is on the backs of 45 million Americans right now? So I think that that countdown is very meaningful to a lot of us.
Now, according to CNBC, student loan forgiveness wasn't included in Biden's 2023 budget proposal, but his administration may consider an extension to the payment pause. What are your thoughts on that?
The first thing is that we're not asking for forgiveness. We're demanding justice, right? This is not something that is a sin or something that we've done that is cause for forgiveness. This is something that's predatory, that's extractive, that's exploitive, that the federal government needs to just decide that it disproportionately affects Black and brown people, poor people, and it needs to just be canceled altogether. And the other part of that is, you know, an extension is cool. You know, I think is a small step forward, but we need to talk about permanent cancellation of all student debt. And we also need to talk more about making education free for all Americans. And, you know, if we want to see ourselves into the future, if we want to invest in our people, then education is an investment that can easily be made. And, you know, school should just be free.
I really like that you mentioned about the forgiveness. I think language is really important when we have these conversations. So I like that you kind of clarified that. So we also found a chart that shows that here in NYC, the percentages of borrowers with over $100,000 in student loans. Do you feel that these pauses are actually helpful to any of this, or do you just feel like they're short-term fixes?
You know, a pause is definitely a short-term fix, but I feel like over the last 2 years, it's been helpful, right? For so many families and individuals that have been struggling through the pandemic, a pause has been something that has been a welcome relief. But I think that, you know, what we really need is for this to be taken one step further and to ensure that we have full cancellation for folks who need it the most. And the other point that I would just want to make is that this is not a giveaway for the wealthy. I think there's a false narrative going around that student loan cancellation is going to benefit, you know, upper class people who went to Yale and Harvard, and that's just not true. Folks who are wealthy and well-to-do had money to pay for school and in general didn't need to take out student loan debt. The majority of folks who took out student loan debt are people of meager means. And not only that, but 40% of people who hold student loan debt don't have a degree. So there are a lot of folks who have student loan debt who haven't actually graduated for one reason or another. And it's just good economic policy to ensure that people are not crippled by owing student loan debt.
So we have a few minutes left. You talked about it earlier, and I kind of want to touch on it again. On your website, you state student loan debt falls disproportionately on people of color and women. Can you explain how these communities are disproportionately affected by this?
Yeah, I can talk about my personal story. You know, I was speaking to my mother yesterday, and I was saying I took out student loans not only to pay for school, but because I was a parent while I was in school, right? So the sacrifices that you have to make while being a student means that I needed money to make sure my rent and bills were paid. I needed money to make sure that my son had a winter coat because I couldn't otherwise afford it, you know, working even full time or part time, trying to keep up with the rigors of academia as well. So, you know, people take on student debt not only for educational expenses, but also to cover the expenses of everyday life that sort of go to the wayside in order for you to be able to maintain while you're seeking higher education. So, this is a personal thing for me, but not only me, but so many others like me who I see struggle, and people who I know can have a better quality of life if not strapped with student debt. I think back in December, I posted a tweet, like, what would we do if we weren't strapped with student debt, right? Like, buy a house, have children, put our children in extracurricular activities, donate to charity, adopt an animal, so many things that we would be able to do with that extra $200, $300, $400, $500, $600, sometimes $700 a month that we're repaying to large companies that have more than enough, while we're juicing and draining the working class who work so hard under the guise that having that piece of paper, that degree, is going to put you in a different socioeconomic status, and we have not seen that come to fruition. So I really want to see the Biden administration act on this, mm-hmm. and I think it's a good thing, and I'm looking forward to seeing some movement on this over the course of the next few weeks.
India, thank you so much for joining me. Before we let you go, can you quickly just let everybody know how they can sign this petition or just join this movement?
Sure. You can visit withoutstudentdebt.org. I also encourage everyone to follow the Debt Collective at Strike Debt at Twitter, and also follow myself at Twitter at India Walton for Buffalo.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll be right back with more Open BxRx Tuesday.
We know that people are dealing with the health crisis, but there's also a lot of food insecurity.
We're giving out healthy food options, and that's what's key here.
If you're a senior, you have a disability, they'll actually deliver meals to you.
The residents are anxious, they're worried, they're scared, and they want to be tested.
When things were happening in our community, and we couldn't get the help.
There's almost a presumption
of criminality that attaches to your skin color.
The site will prioritize those who are at highest risk in the population.
If you feel symptoms and you'd like to visit one of these COVID-19 testing sites here in the Bronx, you may call the state health department's hotline.
Important to note about this site is no reservations are needed. This is a walk-in clinic.
A lot of us are out of work and looking for something to do.
We have the machinery and the skills to make large scales of these masks and gowns.
Take care of your people. It's going to go way further than we actually can understand.
Right now, employees like myself are just adjusting to the new reality.
Welcome back. We had the chance to sit down with the Director of Continuing Education and Workforce Development at Hostos Community College to talk about the first course apprenticeship program. Let's take a look.
Under Hostos Community College, a program dedicated to learning about the art of cooking is looking for new applicants. Director for Continuing Education and Workforce Development, Alexander Seki, joins me to discuss the first course apprenticeship program. Alexander, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you so much for having me, Kibin.
So can you tell me about the Division of Continuing Education and Workforce Development at Hostos Community College?
Yes, we really feel like the Division of Continuing Education and Workforce Development is really, we put the community in Hostos Community College. We've been serving individuals seeking everything from their GED or looking to improve their English through ESL in both tuition and free programs. We have a number of workforce development programs. We're really job skills focused. A great deal of what we do is what we call allied health, which is medical training. So everything from dental assistant, dental hygienist, clinical medical assistant, patient care technician. We also do a variety of professional development, Microsoft Office, a number of licensure programs, such as commercial driver's license, food handler's license. We're going to be launching taxi training sanctioned, commissioned by the Taxi and Limousine Commission. And of course, we're doing culinary arts and IT and you name it. If it has a certificate and a licensure, we're training for it.
So I actually think that's really amazing that, you know, a higher education or a place of higher education also offers just different opportunities to the people in the area. I think that's amazing. You talked about the culinary just a little bit. Can you tell me more about the first course apprenticeship program?
Yes, the first course apprenticeship program is a city-funded grant, which was awarded to Hostos Community College. The goal of it is to train line cooks. Right now, there's a major dearth in trained employees looking to get into the food service industry. As of course you know, pre-pandemic, there are approximately 90,000 food service jobs. That shrunk to 20,000 after lockdown. So Hostos College and Small Business Services in New York City, along with the Food and Beverage Commission, we're looking for some solid recruits who want to get into your high-end professional kitchens around New York City.
So I kind of love that you talked about it being professional. Can you go into a little bit of more detail? Because I'm not someone who's super familiar just with restaurants and cooking. Can you explain how it's a little bit different from, I guess, your average restaurant or fast food restaurant that we may go to?
So the Food and Beverage Commission has been working with a number of restaurant partners for years. This is in partnership with them. Every trainee, after receiving their 8 weeks culinary boot camp with Hostos Community College, will embark on an apprenticeship that's 6 weeks long at one of the partner restaurants. There's a number of big names, which I won't drop at this time, but any individuals who are interested in getting into this industry can attend an info session and learn more about getting through the program.
Now, can you tell me a little bit more about how Hostos College actually became a part of this program?
Yes, it went for RFP, right? There was a request for proposals. Here at Continuing Ed, we've been running culinary arts since 2014. So I guess a combination of our experience, our success record, In terms of churning people out through our regular culinary arts certificate program and getting people into jobs, led them to award us with a $890,000 grant to run three cohorts of approximately 25 individuals. We are actually in week number 8 of the first cohort of this year. We're going to open another cohort in just a few days, April 18th. And we're starting another cohort in June. We anticipate we will be successful and they'll re-up us for another year. So it's going to be an ongoing thing.
Now, what role would those in the apprenticeship take on in this program?
So it's heavily focused on the line cook position in a professional kitchen. You know, usually individuals seeking to break into the industry would perhaps start at the bottom, which is your busboy, dishwasher, prep cook, unless they were able to shell out the tens of thousands of dollars to go to a professional culinary college or institution. The program seeks to give job skills training to individuals who ordinarily wouldn't have that chance or don't have the tuition funding to go to school like that. So we're seeking to break people in kind of at the second tier, you know, and give them the professional training that they need to succeed at their apprenticeship, with the goal that after the 6 weeks apprenticeship, they will be retained by that restaurant as a full-time worker.
Now, I think this is actually really exciting because it's not your traditional learning setting. So can you explain what a typical day of class would look like for people in this program?
Yes, I'm glad you asked. It is not a typical classroom kind of deal. It's not a typical kind of job. The restaurants are generally dinner service only. So the training hours actually mirror the type of work hours they have. It's Monday through Friday, 1 p.m. to 9 p.m. Students come in generally. We do a little bit of lecture for an hour. And then basically they're in the kitchen, hands-on, really working on their knife skills so they can impress their new employers.
Now, not only will there be an opportunity to learn, students will also receive some incentives. Can you tell me more about that?
Yes, absolutely. We understand, like I said, the training is Monday through Friday, 1 p.m. to 9 p.m., very non-traditional hours. Very impossible to hold a full-time job, difficult to hold a part-time job. So in order to alleviate some of the financial burden, all individuals do receive a $325 a week stipend, as well as a weekly MetroCard to try to help alleviate some of the financial burden this would cause, because essentially they're going to be tied up doing this for 8 weeks and then an additional 6.
Now, I really like that resources are being provided. And I feel like nowadays, a lot of people are talking about internships and apprenticeships should be paid. Can you explain the importance of providing resources to people who are in internship programs?
Yeah, and this is backed by solid research. You know, this is a grant-funded program. It's tuition free, but it's there's a you know, pretty intense application process. It's not like if you apply, you can get in. There's multiple levels of interviews. There's intake and assessment that you have to get in, and the research done by Small Business Services as well as CUNY as a whole shows that providing some kind of financial resource, even simply MetroCards, but with a stipend to boot, really boosts retention numbers and really puts trainees' minds at ease that at least they have a little bit of support while they're going through this. I'll also add that there's a case manager attached to the program who can alleviate any kind of issues that the trainees would be having outside of the classroom that may prevent them from attending class or coming on time. So it's really, you know, we try to provide a full service training program.
No, I think the most exciting thing about this is at the end of the program, students will receive access to employment, which I think most people in internships or any apprenticeship looks forward to. Can you tell me more about that?
Like I said, we're working with food and beverage restaurant partners. The restaurant employers, they know that the apprentices are coming. Like I said, we're winding down the first cohort of this year. They're in their final week. They already know what restaurants they've been placed in. They've already been interviewed by their future bosses. So they will go into, you know, the life of a regular professional chef. So that's strange hours, right? Like 1 p.m. to 9 p.m., maybe later, maybe a little earlier. They're going to be working weekends, holidays, right? Because those are the busiest times of the restaurants. But that's why we're recruiting for some individuals who are really, you know, driven, committed, have a passion for food, have a passion for serving customers. And that's why the intake process is very rigorous.
Can you tell me what the requirements are for this program?
Yes, you have to be 18 years of age. You have to be eligible to work in the United States. You have to have a passion for food, of course, and you have to provide proof of income, in a tax document. If you have income over $50,000 a year, unfortunately, you're not eligible for the training.
And how can those that are eligible for this apply, and what are the steps?
We are hosting a number of information sessions. That is the first step. You must go through about an hour-long presentation. I hope it's not too tedious. We try to make it, you know, lively. We encourage questions and answers. We have discussion. It takes approximately an hour, like I said. After that, they would be able to go to the application page. There are numerous info sessions coming up, and it's scheduled through Eventbrite.
And then can you just let us know where people can go to learn more information about this?
Sure, you can just type in First Course NYC in Google. I think it should come up on the nyc.gov site. There's some information there. Interested individuals are welcome to contact me directly at my email, which I think you're going to share. Again, my name is Alexander Seki, and I'd be happy to direct you to an info session and provide more information.
Now, thank you so much for joining me, Alexander. Before I let you go, we have just a minute left. Can you just explain how this program can help out the next generation of chefs?
Yeah, that's a very great point. The chef trainers that we have, between all of them, they must have decades of experience in the restaurant industry, all levels. We have former chef owners, former head chefs, former restaurant owners. We have a couple of published authors. A lot of our chefs do it for the love of the game. They want to pass on knowledge to the next generation. Some of them are semi-retired. And so it's really a great opportunity to share all the knowledge that they have, both on a technical side, but also on a personal side. To help these trainees really thrive once they get on the job.
All right. Well, that's so wonderful. And Alex, once again, thank you for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
We'll be right back with more Open BxRx Tuesday.
When taking public transportation, don't touch your phone. Carry hand sanitizer and use it immediately upon leaving the bus or train. Avoid touching your face. If someone is coughing or sneezing, move away. Wash your hands with soap and water as soon as possible. Limit contact with poles. If possible, avoid rush hour. Don't eat or drink on public transportation. Keep your bag off the floor or other surfaces. Avoid directly touching turnstiles. Stay up to date with the latest from your local health department and CDC.
Welcome back. One Woman is using her platform to inspire and positively influence professionals. Bronx native Andrea Augustus, also known as the Poetic Black Girl, joined me to discuss her work as a poet and public speaker. Andrea, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you so much for having me.
So can you let me know what led you on the path of positively influencing individuals in business and in schools?
Yes. Honestly, for as long as I can remember, I've been always hearing, oh my gosh, you are so articulate. I was the person in class who actually really enjoyed doing those presentations that most of us were scared to do. So when I put together my passion for speaking and articulating myself with my passion for education, it just seemed really natural for me to go ahead and pursue a career in public speaking for people in school, so students, and for corporations and businesses. So really it was just like all of these cool ingredients that I had, you know, just being well-spoken and being creative and loving education. And we went ahead and mixed those together. And that's what really like opened these doors for me.
So on the topic of being creative, the art of poetry is a major part of your work. What are some themes your poetry explores?
Yeah. The art of poetry. I'm the type of person who sees poetry in everything. I think most things are artistic and poetic. And when it comes to my personal pieces, a lot of it stems from my personal experiences as a Black woman growing up in the Bronx. The different things that I've seen, the different ways that I felt in and outside of school, in and outside of friendships, in and outside of family. So what I like to do is take my experiences and write them in a way that isn't just good for people to hear, but it's also healing for myself. So in my piece, Ain't I a Feminist, it's a piece about Black feminism and how as a Black woman, you know, we face discrimination for being a woman, one, and then we also face discrimination for being Black on top of that. I have another piece called Scab, and that kind of digs into the healing process that we go through as we all heal our traumas that we're, you know, in 2022 figuring out and learning to address and navigate with. So Scab is kind of about that healing process. I have so many different things that I talk about, and I think it's cool for people to hear it. Yeah.
Now, you also have a focus on education. I think being from the Bronx, that is super, super important. How do you implement that into your work as well?
Yeah, so in my day-to-day, I actually am a public speaker in schools, right? So what does that mean? What does that look like? I go into different schools in New York City, all the way from the Bronx, where we are, to Brooklyn, Queens, and I give public speaking seminars about different things, how to be more motivated, how to manage time, how to manage stress, different study skills. And these are all, not just study skills, but skills in general. And these are all things that I wish that I knew how to do, or I had somebody come in and talk to me about when I was still in school. When I was in high school, I wish somebody came in and told me, it's all going to be okay. This is how you can manage your time. And this is how you can be a lot less stressed with all the things that you're going through. So I think introducing children to these different skills while we're still, you know, while they're still learning is really important.
I like that you also extended to high schoolers. I was just thinking, you know, college students or people who are career searching, but I think it's actually really important to start early and kind of get those kids motivated early. So I'm really glad to hear you say that you also work with high school students.
Yes. By the time you get to college, you're kind of already set. Okay. You're already half years and years of not managing your time,
right,
or not figuring out how to get motivated. So if we could get a sixth grader or an eighth grader or a 10th grader to figure out how to manage their time and, you know, just these personal development skills, it goes a long way even to their adulthood. So that's the things that, you know, we like to see.
That's amazing. Now, I know one of the topics you also focus on is the importance of diversity and inclusion. I think this is really super important. And I think focusing on identity is something that I just really like in general. Why was that important for you to include that in your work?
Yeah. So as I personally started realizing, like, oh, shoot, I'm speaking in schools and I'm good at speaking in schools. They're realizing what I'm saying. I started to dive deeper into, you know, what a public speaker is, right? So a public speaker is anybody who goes in front of a live audience to make a point or to talk about certain things. So even broadcasting, you know, that's public speaking in a way. So when I go into places that aren't schools, like an organization, a company, a corporation, and I do public speaking, here I'm no longer talking about study skills and time management because they kind of already figured it out. They have a business that is doing well and successful. So here, when my audience is corporations and HR representatives and employees, instead of talking about study skills, we're talking about diversity. We're talking about what it means to have a diverse workplace and how having a diverse workplace actually benefits everyone in that workplace. You know, diversity leads to a lot more problem solving. It has a lot more resiliency just because as people of color, we have been put through a lot. So when your boss is asking you to come up with an idea or a pitch, maybe the first one doesn't go over, we're naturally resilient. So we know how to bounce back and create even more pitches. Diverse workplaces actually make more money. So I like to go into different corporations and talk about what diversity actually looks like, especially on a management level, because we're seeing that in corporations, most of the management is white. And we want to introduce diversity into those management positions. We want the people who are making decisions to be diverse. That way, everything is more well-rounded, more profitable, happier, transparent, and all of that jazz. So me being a Black woman, I am specifically the right person to talk about diversity since I've been to predominantly white institutions, since I've always been a Black woman, since I personally experienced the pain of not having diverse spaces. So yeah, identity is extremely important. It's extremely important.
And then can you explain how understanding your identity could actually strengthen your success professionally?
Yeah. When you know who you are and when you know where you come from and you know your place in the world, you are qualified to take the next step to figure out not only where you're going, but where people who have identities similar to you can go. So I'll bring it to me specifically. As a Black woman, I'm looking to make more spaces for Black people and for people of color in these environments. And doing this helps professionally and personally because it adds a sense of fulfillment, a sense of, okay, as a Black woman, like society will sometimes tell Black women, you know, we're not enough, you know, we're a burden. So instead of it being like, I'm a burden, it's, okay, I'm putting other Black people on in a way that makes sense and in a way that is digestible for not just people of color, but everybody. And yeah, it feels good personally. That's what I would say.
So can you tell me a little bit more about the workshops?
Yes. Okay. Yes. So I started as a poet. That's how I got introduced into being a public speaker in general. Poetry, doing spoken word pieces and doing monologues, so that poetic part of me is really big. So I decided to create space for writers and artists alike to come together and actually create these poems, right? Sometimes we're in school, but there aren't any poetry classes. Or sometimes we graduate from school, but nobody's really pushing us or making the space for us to do poetry. So I actually host poetic workshops where you can, you know, attend with me and we will get you writing a poem that tells your specific story. A poem that represents your identity and who you are. And at the end of the workshop, you'll be a stronger public speaker as you're ready to actually share this poem using all of the tips and tricks that we use in order to really get your point across off stage, on stage, and have that stage presence.
All right. Well, before you go, can you just let everybody know how they can get in contact with you, whether it's for the workshop or if somebody wants you to come speak to their organization or to their school?
Yeah, of course. So my name is Andrea Augustus, also known as the Poetic Black Girl. You can find me on Instagram at Poetic Black Girl. You can also visit my website, www.poeticblackgirl. And if you want to book me for a speaking engagement, the best way to do that is to head on over to www.andreaaugustus.com and tell me all about your company or your school and exactly what you're looking for. And we can go ahead and get that set up. Thank you so much.
All right, Andrea, thank you so much for joining us. You have so many beautiful things to offer. So, you know, I appreciate you taking the time to speak to us about that.
Yes, Kevin, thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited.
So that is all for our show today. Thanks for tuning in. I'm Kim and Alleyne, wishing you and yours safety and wellness now and always. See you next time.